Okay, then we can start with the lesson today. So far we have discussed many things about the Central Bank of Sri Lanka, the structure of the central bank, the operations of the central bank, the responsibilities of the central bank, how the central bank activities influence the economy and the financial system of the country. Many things we discuss in the context of Sri Lanka. But today, going beyond the boundaries that we are going to discuss about the central bank around the world. Here we are going to focus on some leading central banks in the world. You can see the list of central banks that I've selected. Actually, I selected those banks based on the questions raised in the past papers. When you go through the past papers that you can see time to time, in the past papers that we can see, there are a few questions have been asked about the functions of the central banks and also the structure of the central bank of the other countries as well. So this is the list of central banks that we are going to discuss about today. So first, let's see the first central bank, the U.S. Federal Reserve System. U.S. Federal Reserve System is the central bank of the United States. It is so called the Fed. Okay, so this is really, really important monetary authority or an institution in the world at international level. One of the very influencing authority, right? Why? That's why we consider it as the most powerful and influential central bank in the world. So already you have heard many things about the Fed Reserve systems, and time to time we may have so many criticisms on their policies and the attitudes of the governors and all. Very recently also we heard, especially during the financial crisis period in 2008, 2009, that the more focus was given to the operations of the Federal Reserve System. Because why? Right, you can see here I've mentioned that with the US dollar used for approximately 90% of all the world's currency transactions, the Fed activities affect on the valuation of many currencies. So you can see that as the most powerful economy in the world, that their currency is involved in most of the currency transactions around the world. Even in Sri Lanka also, that we evaluate our currency, the external value of our currency also that we determined using the US dollars. Likewise, many of the other countries are same, right? So that's why always that the value of the US dollars and also the interest rate of the US dollars is so, so important for the other countries as well. Compared to our economy, some other emerging economies, they are having more influence because of that policy changes of the Federal Reserve System. Because why? That when compared to the scale of our economy, let's say that India or China, we know that China is having some bans, and we know the Cold War in between the US dollar, US and the China and all, and some other countries as well, in European countries as well, that we can see the level of capital mobility in between these financial systems. So likewise, we can understand how much it is important, the US dollar, in the international currency transactions. Okay, not only in the financial markets, even in the real sectors also, that we can see the influence to the trade. Okay, so that's why this monetary authority is very important. So when we discuss about the history of the Fed Reserve System, we can see that it was founded by Congress in 1913. Just to provide the nation with a safer, more flexible, and more stable monetary and financial system. at the time that we discuss about the history of the overall central banking, we saw that in general that we saw that most of the central banks established to support government fund needed, but gradually they evolved with many other objectives, key objectives. Right? In the same way that over the years, the Fed Reserve System's role is also has expanded with respect to the banking and also over the overall economy. So that it first established in 1913. Okay, so we can see then what are the key roles of the Fed Reserve System. It performs five general functions to promote the effective operations of the US economy and more generally the public interest. So here that they have specifically used that term public interest. You can see when we are going to discuss about the function as well. And also that you have to have that idea about the differences in between the functions of the Central Bank of Sri Lanka and the other central banks, right? So that basically that we can see the key objectives of the Central Bank of Sri Lanka. You know, there are two key objectives. Those are more similar and very common objectives. When we compare the other banks' objective as well, that we can see these key objective of the Central Bank of Sri Lanka is more common and similar to the other central banks. It is a common objectives, right? They are common objectives. But other than that, we discuss about many other roles plays by the Central Bank of Sri Lanka. The same way, these other central banks around the world also, they sometimes that you can see different kind of different roles are there. Okay, we can identify those as well. Especially we have to discuss about the basic operational structure of those central banks and also the key features of their monetary policies that we can see that in the past papers also that there is question on those matters, okay, and also sometimes that it questions about the chairmen or the governors of the key central banks as well. Okay, back into the lesson. So here I have mentioned the five. There are five key functions that we can see. Conduct the nation's monetary policy. It is same as the Central Bank of Sri Lanka, right? But it comes under the key objective of the price stability objective of the Central Bank of Sri Lanka. So here also they have given that stability objectives as well, so that the Fed Reserve conducts the monetary policy with the objective of promoting maximum employment. So in our case that we have not given that much of a focus on the level of employment, but here this is one of the specific feature that we can identify in their policy objectives to promote maximum employment. The stable prices are also there and moderate long-term interest rate in the US economy. That's how it has mentioned in their official website as well, that you can go and visit the website and see. So you better understand it that at the same time they have the responsibility to maintain a stable prices, at the same time that they have to ensure the maximum employment level as well. In order to do so, what they have to do to maintain the long-term interest rates at a moderate level. Okay, so the second one is promote the stability of the financial system. Like in the same way, our central bank, the second key objective of the Central Bank of Sri Lanka also is the same, the stability of the financial system. And to seek, minimize and contain systemic risk through active monitoring and engagement in the US and abroad. so that we discuss about the systemic risk as well. You already know what is the systemic risk. Systemic risk means that in overall the entire system, if they face a risk, that is called the systemic risk. So I hope that you remember that we discuss about the difference between the risk at individual or the group level financial institution, and also the risk at entire level, which is called the systemic risk. So there are two measures, or that there's two measures are there in place in the context of Sri Lanka also to treat those risks, systemic risk and also the individual or the group level risk that we discussed at the time that we discussed about the operations. Hope you remember that there is a separate department in the Central Bank of Sri Lanka. We discuss in detail macroprudential surveillance department, and also we discuss about the bank supervision. So they are monitor the resilience of the institution at individual level, but that the macroprudential level supervision are to oversight any systemic risks. So likewise, here you can see that under the stability of financial system function, the Federal Reserve System is also having these key responsibilities. Then another one is the promotes the safety and soundness of individual financial institutions. Now it is there. So you can see, I already mentioned that the difference between that the stability of the entire financial system and also safety and soundness of the individual financial institutions. Here they have separated it out to two functions, but in our case that we have under the key two objectives that we have put everything together. Okay, the fourth one is fosters payment and settlement system safety and efficiency. Here this function is also common for many other central banks and also to the Central Bank of Sri Lanka as well. So under this function, what they are doing, they are ensuring the safety and efficiency of the payment and settlement system of the country. Through that system, they are servicing the banking industry and also the US government, and also facilitate US dollar transactions and payments. So same that we use our payment and settlement system in the country. The last one promotes consumer protection and community development through consumer focused supervision and examination, research and analysis of emerging consumer issues and trend, community economic development activities, and the administration of consumer laws and regulation. This is one thing that we can see as a difference, because the Central Bank of Sri Lanka is also promotes consumer protection, but we cannot see at the key mandate that we cannot see that it has been given that much of a focus on this aspect. But by the laws that the banking act is there, for the non-bank financial institutions, there is the Financial Business Act is there. In all those acts, actually provides several provisions to ensure the consumer protections and regulation relating to the consumer, their protection and all. In our legal framework also, we can see there are provisions available, but here we can see that they have given a special focus on this area, and especially they focus on the community development. And with respect to the central bank in the Sri Lankan context also, that we can see the central bank is also doing several activities focused on community development. As an example, the regional development department is there. Right, but here that we can see they have given more emphasis on this aspect rather than the central bank of Sri Lanka's functions that we cannot see. We have not actually separate out this function, right? But we are doing that function, and there are what that the measures have been taken to promote consumer protection, but not at that level actually. I think that the reason behind is that their market is so developed and sophisticated, and also the products and services are so dynamic than the products and services available in our markets. It is there, but in our country also that we can see, still there are some issues we can see actually with respect to the informal sector, that we can see there are several issues that faced by the consumers that they need to be protected. That at the moment our country also considering some advanced legal framework to capture those segments and to get them into under the regulation and to give more protections to the consumer protection laws. That's what we can see. Okay, so now here you can see the structure of the Fed system. So the Federal Reserve System, that we can see there are key three entities. This is actually the governance entities that you can see, that Federal Reserve Board of Governors. It is also called Board of Governor of the Fed. It is the key entity. And then we can see under that national level, it is like the top national level governance entity, the Federal Reserve Board of Governor. Under that, there are 12 Federal Reserve banks are there. We are going to discuss about these key entities in detail, right? And the other one is the Federal Open Market Committee. And also that you can see what are the key functions of the Federal Reserve System, conducting the national monetary policy, helping maintain the stability of the financial system. Likewise, that already we discussed those five elements, okay, five functions. So here, I just wanted to mention about the key entities, the Federal Reserve Board of Governors, 12 Federal Reserve banks are there, Federal Open Market Committee. So let's go and see in detail one by one. The Federal Reserve Board of Governors, the Board of Governors, it is located in the Washington, D.C., is the governing body of the Federal Reserve System. So it is the key or the top level governance entity. So it oversight the overall operations of the Federal Reserve System. Which means that it is a network of the Federal Reserve banks. There are 12 Federal Reserve banks for the different districts in USA. USA is a huge country, it's a big continent. So that we can see there are actually that the district have been demarcated based on the economic perspectives, basically. So that we can see there are 12 Federal Reserve banks are there for each district. So these all work as a network, so which is the Federal Reserve System actually. So that the overall the supervision is by the Board of Governors, Federal Reserve Board of Governors. It in turn by 7 members, the governors who are nominated by the President of U.S. states and confirmed in their position by U.S. Senate. So that we can see in the Board of Governors, there are 7 members are there. All those 7 members are appointed by the President. And also that nomination should be confirmed by the U.S. Senate as well. The Board of Governors guide the operation of the Fed Reserve System to promote the goals and fulfill the responsibilities given to the Federal Reserve by the Federal Reserve Act. So this governance entity has been established by the Federal Reserve Act, and also a specific responsibilities have been given, okay, to be fulfilled by this board of governors. Their responsibility is to make the system to work to meet those responsibilities. The governors of this board of governors, that there are seven members are there, no? So they serve for 14 years to ensure stability and continuity over time. That's what the difference that we can see here, that they can serve for about 14 years continuously in order to maintain the stability and the continuity of their policy formulation. That's why. So that you may have heard the name of the Jerome H. Powell, one of the very popular economist at international level. When someone is talk about the international monetary policy and all, definitely that we have to mention the name of Jerome H. Powell. Okay, so and the vice chairman is the Richard Clarida. So you can find all those details from their official website as well. Time to time in the papers I saw that you have to select the correct name. It's like ICQs that you have to select the correct name of the present chairman and all. That's why I wanted to just mention those names, but I recommend you to go and check the website and get updated before the exam, because we don't know when you are going to give the exam. In between the period, sometimes the positions can be changed. So better when you get ready to the exam that you go and check and get the most updated details, especially on these positions. Okay. And the chairman that you now know who is, and the vice chairman, they are appointed to 4 years term and may be reappointed subject to term limitations. Very recently also that we heard so many criticism about the measures introduced by the Jerome Powell, whether he's suitable or not, like that. Okay. And here in the dark blue color, I mention what are the key responsibilities given to the Board of Governors. The Board of Governors, they oversee the operations of 12 reserve banks and share with them the responsibility for supervising and regulating certain financial institutions and activities. Now here that we saw there are three entities, right? Federal Reserve Board of Governors, 12 Federal Reserve's banks, and also there is another committee, okay, which is called Federal Open Market Committee. So it is the place where always formulate all the monetary policy measures, okay, that we are going to discuss in later. But you have to understand the level of responsibilities given for these different three entities, okay. So that the Federal Reserve Board of Governors is actually at the top level that we saw, so that they oversee the overall operation of 12 reserve banks, and also they give the responsibility of supervising and regulating certain financial institution and activities to those 12 reserve banks. And then it provides general guidelines, direction, and oversight when the reserve banks lend to depository institution. That now you can see that in 12, that there are different districts, 12 districts. For each district, there are different separate reserve banks are there. So that these reserve banks are supervising the financial institutions and their activities at district level. So that in order to do that, this Federal Reserve Board of Governors provide general guidelines, directions, and also oversight when the Reserve Bank lend to depository institutions and others. There are different type of institutions are there. Basically, we can identify the major category as depository institutions in USA. So these reserve banks lend to depository institutions, like in the same way that the central bank lend to the Laotian banks. And others, when the reserve banks provide financial services to depository institutions and the federal government. Here also that our case also that we know, we also provide funds to the Laotian banks and also to the government. Okay, so that sets, so in order to set reserve requirement for depository institutions and also to approve the changes in the discount rates, those all are recommended according to the guidelines given by the Federal Reserve Board of Governors. As part of this oversight, the board reviews and approves the budget of each of reserve banks, which is also one important functions of the Federal Reserve Board of Governors. The board also helps to ensure that the voices and concerns of consumers and communities are heard at the central bank by conducting consumer focus supervision. This is more related to the this function is more related to one of the key functions that we already discussed. I told you that one of the key factor that we can identify in between our function and the Fed Reserve function was that they are more focused on consumer protection and all. So here you can see one of the responsibility given to the Federal Reserve Board of Governors also linked with that key function of the Fed. That's why they always conduct some research and supervision works to check whether the consumers are properly served by the financial and economic environment or the measures taken by the authority. Okay, so that's why they are using research and do research and policy analysis. More generally, by promoting a fair and transparent consumer financial services market. So they have given more focus on the interest of the consumers or the public. Okay, it is one of the key difference that we can identify. And then the board's most important responsibility is participating in the Federal Open Market Committee. We are going to discuss about the role of the Federal Open Market Committee after a while. Okay, so then the Federal Reserve Banks. There are 12 Federal Reserve Banks and also 24 branches. They are like the operating arms of the Federal Reserve System. That Federal Reserve System is actually the network of these 12 Federal Reserve Banks. And these banks are operate under the general oversight of the Board of Governors that we saw, under the responsibilities of the Board of Governors that we saw. Key responsibility is to oversight these Federal Reserve Banks. So each reserve bank's board of directors are responsible for overseeing their bank's administration and governance, reviewing the bank's budget and overall performance, overseeing the bank's audit process, and developing board strategic goals and direction. So now we are going to discuss about the monetary policy of the Fed, and that at that time you will see who is formulating the policy, who is implementing the policy. So here that you can see each of the Fed Reserve Bank that they have their own Reserve Bank Board, and what are the responsible given for the Fed Reserve Banks level. So see the responsibilities, I list down them, 1, 2, 3, 4 key responsibilities have been given: supervising and examining state member banks. State member banks, remember, those are state member banks, state chartered banks that have chosen to become members of the Federal Reserve System. So those are actually a part of the member of the Federal Reserve Banks. They have some capital requirement as well accordingly. Bank and thrift holding, other than that bank, that examining the state member banks are there, and also some other banks, thrift holding companies and non-bank financial institutions, that they have been designated as systematically important under authority delegated to them by the board. so that we can see, like in the same way we have our life and commercial banks are there, specialized banks are there, non-banks are there, microfinance companies are different level of financial entities are there in the system. So here also this reserve banks, they're responsible to supervise and examining all these banks in the system, lending to the depository institutions to ensure liquidity in the financial system. So that role is common to the Central Bank of Sri Lanka as well. That supervising and examining role is also there. Okay, and the next thing is the providing key financial services that undergird the nation's payment system, including distributing the nation's currency and coins to depository institution, clearing check, operating the Fed wire, that it is again a system in place to facilitate the transactions, and also servicing as the bank for the US Treasury. So these are the functions given to the, or the responsibilities given to the Federal Reserve Bank. Examining certain financial institutions to ensure and enforce compliance with federal consumer protection. That here again you can see that there is a different kind of a framework. Supervisory framework is there to ensure the compliance with respect to the consumer protection regulation and fair lending laws, while also promoting local community development. So reserve banks interact directly with banks in their district to examinations and financial services, and bring important regional perspective that help the entire Federal Reserve System do its job more effectively. So that here one thing that I have to mention you all, that now you can see among the responsibilities, you cannot see that they are implementing monetary policy or the exchange rate policy and all. Now that's what the difference that we can identify. Okay, so we are going to discuss at the next layer, that which is that Federal Open Market Committee. Actually, this is the place where take all the monetary policy decisions. Okay, so that we are going to discuss. So here that you see here that the district levels, 12 Federal Reserve Banks are there, but their responsibility is more on the more on what? On the objective of maintaining the stability of the financial system, right? But by doing so, that actually they facilitate through the financial system, we know that it facilitates the overall stability of the economy and also the price stability as well. But here directly that they have no involvement with the monetary policy implementation and all. That's what we can see. Okay, then let's go and see what is the responsibility or the operational behavior of the third entity, Federal Open Market Committee, FOMC. FOMC sets national monetary policy. So now we can see that although there are 12 different Fed Reserve banks are there at district levels, there is the one common national monetary policy is there. So all the monetary policy decisions are being taken by this Federal Open Market Committee. Okay, so that they take the decisions regarding the conduct of open market operations, which affect the federal fund rate. Federal fund rate is the one of the policy tool, right? That rate at which depository institutions lend to each other. So that we discuss about that Fed reserves that they lent into the depository institutions, right? One of the functions of the Federal Reserve Banks is to lend depository institution. Okay, so that's in doing so, one of the key rate important is federal funds rate, and also that the open market operation. We already know what is open market operations, right? So under the monetary policy of the central bank also that we discuss about the monetary open market operation, one of the key policy tools at the disposal of the Central Bank of Sri Lanka to implement the monetary policy. So here the Federal Open Market Committee, so they conduct open market operations that it is going to be impact on the federal fund rates. Okay, so that we also saw how the open market operations are going to be impact on the rates in the short-term money markets that we saw at the time that we discussed about the monetary policy in Sri Lanka. Okay, and also the size and the composition of the Fed Reserve's assets holdings and communication with the public about likely further course of monetary policy. Those are the responsibilities of the Federal Open Market Committee. So now we have to identify. Now you have to identify these key responsibilities of this committee. Okay, so now we are going to discuss about the composition of this committee. It consists of 12 voting members. Among these 12 voting members that we can see, we saw in the Board of Governors there are 7 members. So all those 7 members are there representing this committee as well. In addition to that, okay, the President of the Federal Reserve Bank of Namibia. In addition to that, the Reserve Bank of New York. In the New York, there is a Reserve Bank now. So their president is also there. Okay. And also there are 4 other members representing the other Reserve Bank presidents. Not all the Reserve Banks are, not all the chairmen of the Reserve Banks are not always represent. Actually, they are going to sit and they are going to be there representing, but voting capacity is given only for 12 members. Okay, so the 12 members only have the voting power. Voting power means that they have to vote for the monetary policy decisions. So that when then only that they can have the confirmation on whatever the decisions that they are taking. So that there are 12 members, 7 members who are the Board of Governors, appointed by the president that we saw earlier. So other than that, always that president or the governor of the Federal Reserve Bank is Bank of New York is there. You will see why, because that almost all the measures are being, that monetary policy measures are being implemented by the Reserve Bank of New York, especially the open market operations. That's why that president is indeed is a member of the FOMC. And then other 4 presidents of the remaining reserve banks, actually they are going to turns on rotating basis. Okay, and the one of the member is going to serve 1-year terms. Okay, all 12 of the Reserve Bank presidents attend FOMC meetings are here. I already mentioned that. Even though there are only selected 4 or the 5 members are representing the MOMC, the presidents of the Reserve Banks, but all 12 presidents are there, attend into the committee meetings, okay, committee decisions. And they participate in the discussion, but only the presidents who are committee members at a time may vote on policy decisions. Only 12 voting members are there. That's how that composition of the Federal Open Market Committee. They typically meets 8 times a year in Washington, D.C. So it is like the same way in Sri Lanka that we also have our monetary policy decisions rounds at 8 times per year in normal circumstances. Okay, at each meeting, the committee discusses the outlook for the U.S. economy and monetary policy options and design policies to promote a stable prices and economic growth by managing the nation monetary money supply. That you know, I no need to more stress on those terms because we already know stable prices, you know what is a stable prices, economic growth, you know, and the money supply that we all discuss already. Okay, so that you can see this similar their objective of taking the monetary policy to the same objective like the central bank has. Okay, this committee is an example of the independence built into Fed's structure. So that is this is what we can observe. Because of this committee is making all the decisions, that we can see the level of independence it has. It combines the expertise of the Board of Governors. So the Board of Governors are the expertise in the field, and also Reserve Banks, 12 Reserve Banks are there. They all giving inputs to the decisions making process. Only 12 members are having the voting power, including the governors, 7 governors, but yet we can see that all the reserves banks at district levels, that they are providing inputs in this decision making process. Regional input from the reserve bank directors and advisory groups bring the private sector perspective to the committee and provide grassroots input for the monetary policy decision. So likewise, that we can see US is a huge country in the landscape, that we can see that's a very huge country, but that they have the national monetary policy, but that national policy can accommodate the requirement of the overall country. Because why? Because of this, the structure of this committee, that we can see that inputs are coming throughout the districts in order to take the final decisions. Okay. Okay, so there are some more information about the Federal Open Market Committee. By tradition, the chairman of the FOMC is the chair of the Board of Governors. Okay, so that we saw that who is the chair of the Board of Governors, Mr. J.M. H. Powell. So in tradition, he is going to be chair this FOMC as well. Okay, so that so he has taken up the position in 2018. He first appointed, not actually the first, but in this term he has appointed in 2018. The vice chairman of the FOMC is the president of the Federal Reserve Bank of New York. That it is again a compulsory thing, that it is by mandate that the president of the Fed Reserve Bank of New York is the vice chairman of this FOMC. The position currently filled by Mr. John C. Williams. Okay, you better remember those names, these names. Okay, the FOMC has 8 regularly scheduled meeting each year, but they can meet more often if the need should arise. Like in the same way here in Sri Lanka, so that normally the monetary policy decisions are taking at 8 times per year, but when there is any emergency or any turbulent situation in an economy, that we know some rapid solution to be taken. So at that time, this regular schedule can be changed. During the meeting, members discuss development in the local and global financial markets as well as economic and financial forecasts. Okay, so that it is also same that here for the US, that they are more open to the overall world. So that because of the level of engagement that they have with the rest of the world, that they have to consider more and more factor compared to our level. That I'm telling that because it's a huge market in the world, so that they have to consider many factors. Okay, so that economic factors and also some financial factors, and also they use different type of forecasts in order to take their decisions. After much deliberation by all participants, only designated members can vote that we already discussed. The Fed's Board of Governor is in charge of setting the discount rate and reserve requirements. So that discount rate and the reserve requirements are two key important policy tools used by the Fed, so that when setting up those rates or the discount rate or the reserve requirements in the board, that we can see that the boards of governors are the in charge. So FOMC is especially in charge of open market operations. So that we can see, again, I'm telling you that the difference in between the decision make they are making, okay? So that in the monetary policy mechanism, the open market operations are there, and also it is one of the tools that the Fed can use, okay? And also the discount rate and the reserve requirements are also there. So the discount rate and reserve requirements are like predetermined things that decide by the board of governors, okay? In order to maintain that discount rates and all that open market operations are conducting, so that with respect to the open market operations, always that FOMC is responsible, okay? So that's why it says so, that FOMC is specifically in charge of open market operations, but Fed's Board of Governor is in charge of setting the discount rate and reserve requirement. Okay, since we have already discussed about the monetary policy implementation of our country, that we saw that we also have some policy rates predetermined by the central bank. By implementing the open market operations, what we are doing, we are actually influence the market interest rates, right, to maintain these market rates, and also we try to make them align with the policy interest rates. In the same way, the Fed Reserve also implementing their monetary policy as well. Okay, so I hope that you can understand. To implement the monetary policy actions, the committee issue a directive to the New York Fed domestic trading desk that guides the implementation of the committee's policy through open market operation. So that's why I told you that the New York Reserve Bank is more important. They are doing very specific role when compared to the other reserve banks in other districts. Why? Because that domestic trading desk is there in the New York Reserve Banks. They are actually implementing the open market operation. Now, in our case, that we don't have any branches or any that we Central Bank of Sri Lanka is also have six regional offices, but they are doing other different roles. No, they are not involved in the monetary policy operations, okay, at all. But we have a separate department called the Domestic Operations Department. Oh, like in the same way that New York Fed Domestic Trading Desk. So that our Domestic Operations Department established in the central bank is conducting all the market operation, open market operations. Okay, so that is our structure. But here their structure is quite different, and the New York Federal Reserve Bank is having that domestic trading desk, and they are implementing the open market operations according to the directions given by the FOMC. So that's how it is working. And then we are going to discuss some more about the Federal Reserve's monetary policy. The goal of monetary policy are to promote maximum. Hold on a minute, I just wanted to check whether you all are there with me. Yes. Let me just check the text box, chat box a little. Yeah, nothing there. Let me go back to the presentation. Okay, we are here. Okay, Federal Reserve's monetary policy. So the goal of the monetary policy are to promote maximum employment. Here I like to highlight on this point, promote maximum employment, right? So we discussed that it is one of the difference that we can see. A stable prices and moderate long-term interest rate. By implementing effective monetary policy, their objective is to maintain price stability or the stable prices. By doing so, they wanted to support long-term economic growth. That's the same way. And also the maximum employment. Okay. The Fed's mandate for monetary policy is commonly known as dual mandate. Sometimes you may have asked why the monetary policy of the Fed system is known as dual mandate. Because why? There are key two objectives are there behind low and stable inflation rate. Their objective is to maintain the inflation at 2% per year, which means that growth of the interest rate should not be more than that, like that 2% level. Okay, and at the time that we discuss about the our inflation target that we told, it should be at the mid-single level. Okay, that is what our target. Here, their target is to keep the inflation at low and a stable level at around 2% per year. And also, the other target is maximum employment level that can be sustained. Okay, so that's why it is called a dual mandate. The Reserve, Fed Reserve's three instruments of monetary policy are already I mentioned: open market operations, discount rate, and reserve requirements. Now you know that discount rate and reserve requirements are that they basically in charge of these two tools are the Board of Governors, and also FOMC is in charge of open market operation policies. That's what we discussed. So let's see what is open market operation, discount rate, and reserve requirement. So already we discussed about the open market operation in the context of Central Bank of Sri Lanka, right? But here also that we can see some the same thing, but in a different what the basically the objective is similar, but the way of implementing is somewhat different. The Fed uses open market operation as its primary tool to influence the supply of bank reserves. Okay, so either Fed can purchase securities, okay, or sell financial instruments. Okay, that they basically use that securities issued by the US Treasury. So the central bank also basically use that government securities. So like in the same way, they also use the securities issued by the US Treasury and also some other federal agencies and government sponsored enterprises. So basically linked with the government. Okay, so that by doing so, either they can absorb excess reserves or increase the reserves in the banking system. Open market operations are carried out by the domestic trading desks of the Federal Reserve Bank of New York under the direction from the FOMC. I already mentioned that. The transactions are undertaken with primary dealers. So all that through the domestic trading desks that we can see the primary dealers are there. They have accounts in the Fed bank so that when the Fed wants to increase reserves, it buys securities from the primary dealers and pay for their for them through the through their accounts maintained at the Fed. Okay, so that they have their accounts maintained at the Fed so that when they're buying securities they can pay, which means that the bank reserves are going to be increased. When the Fed wants to redeem reserves, it sells securities and collects from those accounts. Okay, By trading securities, the Fed influences the amount of bank reserves, which affect the federal funds rate. Like in the same way, if you could understand the monetary policy operations that we already discussed, that this is nothing much you to worry about, that you can understand what is going on, right? When the Fed is through the open market operations, the central bank, central banks of Sri Lanka also doing the same kind of a functions, either can increase the level of liquidity or decrease the level of liquidity by buying and selling securities. Okay, so by doing so, that we know that federal funds rate can be changed, because we already discussed the availability of money and the cost of money. What are the relationship between these two? So when we are going to change the available level of liquidity, that we can influence the price or the rates, funds rates. Okay, so likewise, that this open market operation, it affects the federal fund rates or the overnight lending rate at which banks borrow reserves from each other. Like the same way in the overnight money market that we discussed. So now you can understand, even I show you the graphs as well. So how the rates, interest rate is going up and down according to the fund availability, supply increase and decreasing. Okay, the federal funds rate is sensitive to changes in the demand for and supply of reserves in the banking system, and thus in turn directly influences other short-term rates and indirectly influences long-term interest rates. Here also, that we discussed, when central bank change the supply of and the supply of money or the demand for money, okay, by doing open market operations, so it changed the short-term interest rate in the money market, and later on in the long run, it is going to change the interest rate in the market, loanable fund markets and all, before loanable fund market, that capital market as well. So that in the same way, by implementing these open market operations, Feds also influence the short-term and long-term interest rates in the market, and also foreign exchange rates, and also the supply of credit and demand for investment, employment and economic output. So when we are going to change the interest rates, that you know, the foreign exchange rate is also going to be changed. Why? It is again a longer story behind that. But that exchange rate is also sensitive to the changes in the domestic interest rate, okay, against the international interest rates as well. So likewise, that by doing open market operations, now you can see how many elements of the economy can be influenced by the Fed Reserve System or the monetary policy of the Fed. Okay, so that availability of supply of credits, so that when there is more credits are there, that means that credits are available at a lower rate, so the investment will increase. So when investment is increasing, that employment opportunities are also increasing, so that we can see the economic output also increasing. Likewise, that by implementing the monetary policy, the Fed Reserve can influence the overall economic activities of the country. Okay, so now we are going to discuss about the discount rate. The interest rate charged by Fed Reserve banks to depository institutions on short-term loans. It is the discount rate. It is like the policy interest rate determined by the Central Bank of Sri Lanka. Okay, so that the discount, based on the discount rate, it decide the rate for the depository institutions, because the if they have any shortage or excess, that they have to either deposit those excess cash with the central bank or the Fed, or even that they have to borrow, so that all these activities are actually based on this discount rate. So that's why the discount rate is also important. It is also key monetary policy instrument used by the Fed. And the next one is the reserve requirement. We discuss about the SSR, right? In our case, that it is statutory reserve ratio, statutory reserve requirement. Okay, so that here the reserve requirement, the portions of deposits that banks must maintain either in their wallets or on deposit at the Federal Reserve Bank. So already discussed what is the impact of changing this reserve requirements and changing the availability of money in the market. So it's the same thing. So I cannot explain everything again. If you could understand the monetary policy tools and the mechanism that implement by the central bank, we already discussed that, you can easily understand this point as well. Okay, so then we can move to the next central bank of the world, the European Central Bank. The European Central Bank is the central bank of the 19 European Union countries which have adopted the euro. So these all 19 European countries are using the common currency of euro, so that they are under one roof, like it is the European Central Bank. The first step towards creating the European Central Bank was the decision taken in 1988 to build an economy and monetary union. Why? For free capital movements within the Europe, a common monetary authority, and a single monetary policy across the Euro area countries. Those are the common objectives of establishing that European Central Bank, or the Economic and Monetary Union of Europe. So accordingly, later on, actually, those were the key objective of establishing the Economic and Monetary Union of Europe. So one of the objective of that monetary union is to establish single monetary policy. So accordingly, in 1999, this European Central Bank was established. Okay, because of most of the countries are using common currency, right? So accordingly, now we can see there are 19 member countries are there in the European member nations. It is one of the most critically important central bank in the world, supervising over 120 central and commercial banks in the member states. So in addition to that 19 European central banks, you can see more than nearly 100 key commercial banks are also there under the supervision or the regulations of the European Central Bank. So that's why this central bank is also considered as a key central bank or the monetary authority in the world. The ECB works with the central banks in each EU state to formulate monetary policy to help maintain stable prices and strengthen the euro. So you can here see this European Central Bank is basically two things that we can see: formulate monetary policy to help maintain stable prices. Stable prices is one thing, and also strengthen the euro. Okay, because they are using common currency. The Governing Council of the ECB is the group that decided on changes to the monetary policy, like in the same way that we saw under the Fed Reserve System. Here also the Governing Council is the group decide on the monetary policy. The council consists of six members of the executive board of CEB. So that we can see the top layer is the Governing Council of the ECB, and then the executive board of ECB. There are six members of the executive board of ECB. They all are the members of the governing council. And also the governors of all the national central banks from 19 eurozone countries. So other than that, all the governors of each European zone countries are there. It is the structure of this governing council. And the bank's mandate is to keep prices stable in the euro area. So which is the key mandate. According to the mandates, that key responsibility given is that to keep prices stable in the euro area and contribute to the safety and soundness of the European banking system while ensuring that growth is sustainable. And again, that you can see that a stability in the financial system is also there, which is called the safety and soundness of the European banking system. Unlike the Fed, ECB strive to maintain the annual growth in consumer prices below 2%. Okay, so that that we saw that with respect to the Fed reserves, that their target is to maintain the inflation at 2%, but ECB, their target is to maintain it at below 2%. And also because that most of the European countries are export oriented countries, means that they depend basically on export economies. They also has they also have the responsibility, which means the European Central Bank, that they try to prevent excess strength in the currency, because this poses a risk to its export market. Now you have to understand what it is. What means that excess strength in their currency means that if the euro is going to be appreciate highly, right, when the euro is going to be highly appreciate, okay, for the exporters, actually that they can earn less euros. Because that if that how many that exchange rate, let's say that euro exchange rate, how many euros per $1? Okay, so appreciate means that there are less euros for $1, so that exporters, that they can earn less euros. That's why if it is going to be more strong their currency, it is not good for the exporters, because they can earn less euros. That's why that one of the other responsibility of the European Central Bank is to preventing excess strength in their currency, okay, for the interest of the export countries, because they most of the European countries in the region are export oriented countries. Okay, so that is one of the key difference that we can identify in their policy objectives. And with respect to some other countries also that we can see, especially the Japan also, that we can see the same situation. Organization structure of the ECB. There are four decision making bodies of the ECB that are mandated to undertake the objectives that here you can see. The governing council is there, the executive board is the second layer, and the general council and the supervisory board. Okay, the governing council, it is comprises of governors of the National Central Bank of the Euro area members status, and six members of the executive board, and meet twice a month at the institution's office in Germany. So that they meet twice a month. And you can see the composition of this board. The primary function is to formulation of monetary policy for the euro. So this is the key function. And make decisions on monetary objectives, interest rates, and the supply of reserves in euro system to ensure the performance of function of euro system. So that what you have to understand is what the key role given to the each layers of these government entities. Okay, and the second one is the executive board. comprises the president, vice presidents, and four other executive members appointed by the European Council and serve for an 8 years non-renewable term. So this is how the composition of the executive board. So what is the key role? Implement the monetary policy. So now you can see the difference in between. The governing council, actually they are responsible to formulate the monetary policy. The executive board is responsible to implement the monetary policy. They are actually the layer who execute the policy. Implement means that they are taking decisions, that decisions is there, that decisions are executed by the executive board. And what is the role of the general council? That you can see the comprises of that council composition. The general council, as a traditional body, the general council is tasked with fixing the exchange rate of currencies for countries taking up the euro. Okay, so that there is a fixed rate. There are different countries in the region, so that all the countries that they have taken up euro as their common currency, so that they have to pay with the fixing exchange rate among these. So that responsibility is with this general council. The council also contributes to the preparation of the ECB annual report, setting condition of employment for the European Central Bank members of a staff and collecting data. So these are the responsibilities given to the General Council. And the Supervisory Board comprises the Chair, Vice Chair, four ECB representative and representative of the National Supervisors. They plan and execute the supervisory function of the ECB. Okay, so these are the functions given to the different layers of this ECB. We have to give more focus on the first two layers because they are responsible. They are responsible for the monetary policy implementation. Okay, so what is the slide we are now? Okay, so in overall, what are the key roles of the ECB? The primary function is to maintain price stability and safeguard the value of euro. The governing council defined price stability as inflation below but close to 2% over the medium term, which is their target objective. The price stability is essential for promoting economic growth and job creations that we already discussed. At the time that we discuss about the influence of the activities of the central bank, the context of Sri Lanka that we discussed, at that time you saw what are the relationship between the inflation and the economic activities, okay, or the consumption patterns, investments and all, interest rate, how they are going to influence on the economic decisions of the people. Likewise, that you can understand now. So that here also that it clearly mentioned that price stability is essential for promoting economic growth and job creation, which is that is why it is major objective of the central bank of this area. The ECB has a monopoly on the issuing of banknote in the euro area. So for all 19 countries, or not only the 19 countries actually, but for in the euro area, in order to issue euro currency, that sole authority is with the European Central Bank. It influences the amount of money in the market by controlling money available to eligible central and commercial bank in EU member states. So that it be, because it is the common currency. So the level of availability is always determined by the ECB. So that they make announcement weekly on the amount of money it plans to supply and the minimum acceptable interest rate. So that those information are very, very highly important for the players in the economy. Eligible banks that have provided collateral then place their bids for the ECB funds through an auction mechanism. Once the banks have obtained funds, they use them to advance loan to individuals and businesses in the same way that how central bank provide cash to the commercial bank. It is kind of a funds facility, right? So the banks that they have to provide collaterals in a bid auction. So at that time, they can have funds from the central bank, and they use these funds to meet the needs of the individuals and the businesses. And the ECB is responsible for banking supervision in all the EU member states and carries out this function through the single supervisory mechanism that comprises the ECB and competent national authorities in the member countries. This is one of the specific feature that we can identify with respect to this ECB, right? So that for all the member countries, that there are 19 member countries are there, so ECB is responsible for banking supervision. So there is a single supervisory mechanism for all the financial institution in the member countries. Okay, this is one thing, that one difference that we can see in the under the Fed Reserve systems that we didn't see. There was no single supervisory mechanism, although that some of the common measures have been taken by the Board of Governors, but still that we saw that district levels that there is a supervisory mechanism in place in US, but here there is a single supervisory mechanism. The ECB has the power to grant and withdraw banking license, conduct supervisory reviews, and set higher capital requirement to counter financial risk. So that's how they are going to regulate the banking sector or the financial institution. So they grant all the approval or the license for them to do their operations, or even cancel those license, and also set capital requirements. That requirements can be different based on the level of risk the banks exposed, right? The CEB directly supervise 124 significant banks that hold 82% of the banking assets in the euro area. So now you can see the role of the ECB is highly important in the stability of the financial system in this area. See that how many significant banks that they are there under their supervision. Other responsibilities including conducting foreign exchange operations, formatting the proper functioning and safety of payment system, and managing the Eurozone's foreign currency reserves. So these are very common activities for the other banks, other central bank as well. In our context also that we can see, the Central Bank of Sri Lanka is also conducting foreign exchange operations, time to time intervene to the domestic foreign exchange market, and also the regulator. So there is a role as the regulator of the payment system as well. And also, here you can see managing the Eurozone's foreign currency reserves. So that overall area or the zone that there is a reserve. So it is also under the custody of the ECB. Okay, so the next one is monetary policy of the ECB. They use interest rate as major monetary policy tool. In addition to setting key interest rate, they conduct open market operations as well, right? The governing council of the ECB sets three key interest rates. So that you already know the governing council that we saw, their key responsibility is to, yeah, let's go and see again, okay? So formulation of monetary policy for the euro. So likewise that we can see they are taking these decisions. So accordingly, they determine three key interest rates. These all three interest rates are predetermined or the preset rates. The first one is the interest rate on the main refinancing operation. In those operations, bank can borrow liquidity from the euro system against collateral on weekly basis. So here you can see against collateral, the banks can have borrow liquidity from the ECB on weekly basis. And the next one is that deposit facility. Bank can deposit the excess cash overnight basis, right, with the ECB. Okay, and also there is a lending facility rate, which is these two rates are more likely that very similar to the rates that the Central Bank of Sri Lanka also have for its interest rate, like standing deposit facility rate, standing lending facility rate. This is the functions and the objective of these rates are also very similar to those. The rates on the marginal lending facility means which offers overnight credit to banks from the euro system at an interest rate above the main refinancing operation rate. So that refinance operation rate that you can compare the three rates here. So the deposit facility rate is lower than the main refinancing operation rates. Marginal lending facility is above the main refinancing operation rate, and both these facilities are on overnight basis. Okay, so the rate on the deposit facility and the rate on the marginal lending facility define a corridor. So, like in the same way that we use standing deposit facility rate and the lending facility rate, so the deposit facility and marginal lending facility, they make a corridor of interest rate and overnight interest rate actually. So the bank can normally that as the same way that we saw in Sri Lanka also that overnight call money market that the bank can interact to meet their liquidity requirements and the rates are determined in between these key policy rate corridor. So the like in the same way here also we can see that banks can lend to each other in any rate in between this rates corridor. Okay, the deposit facility rates acts as the floor of this corridor, and the marginal lending facility act as the ceiling, which means that deposit rate is at the lower bound and the lending facility is at the high bound. Okay, so that very similar to the system we have in Sri Lanka. Monetary policy of the ECB, non-standard measures. Those are actually that these all policy measures that we can consider as conventional monetary policies. But going beyond that, we can see the recent past, some non-standard measures or the extraordinary measures have been taken by the ECB to address some issues, especially at the time of the financial crisis around 2008, they introduced several non-standard monetary policy measures. The primary aim of ECB's non-standard measures was to provide liquidity to market and to keep financial market functioning. In the pandemic situation also, even the Central Bank of Sri Lanka also adopted some non-conventional policy measures in order to ensure enough liquidity are there in the market, try to inject more and more liquidity to boost economic activities. Okay, like in the same way at that time actually due to financial crisis in 2007-8 that Sri Lanka we did not affected that much. Okay, but we saw the impact. It began actually, it formulated in the US, but we can see the bad influence to the Euro area countries as well. So that's why we can see the ECB had to introduce several extraordinary measures. Okay, so that here you can see the it has mentioned some of such measures. In 2008, banks could no longer rely on borrowing from each other, which means that there was a very dry liquidity situation there in the market. So that European Central Bank, they have to provide unlimited credit to the banks at a fixed interest rate. Okay, so that it is called fixed rate full allotment, means that at a fixed rate that they have to provide credits to the banks. The range of eligible assets that could be used as collateral in refinancing operation was expanded. Under the normal circumstances, actually there are set of collaterals are accepted, not all the collaterals, but because that the banks are under stress liquidity situation, that central bank allowed them to use some different type of collateral, so that that collateral base has been expanded. It is one of the new measure. In the second phase of the crisis, which took the form of a sovereign debt crisis after the financial crisis, especially the Eurozone countries, that they had to face another crisis because it is called the sovereign debt crisis, in order to address the malfunctioning. So that again, the European Central Bank has to take additional measures to boost economic activities, so that they purchase debt securities. Normally, we know that in the in under the monetary policy transactions, that normally we can see that always the government securities are used, or that the less risk securities are used by the banks, and only those such type of securities are accepted by the central banks. But going beyond that, they started to accept different type of securities. Okay, so and also that they that under the normal circumstances, central bank lent for the banks for a short term basis, maybe for about a weekly basis, overnight basis. But considering the crisis, that central bank has started to give funds or lend to the banks in long-term basis. Okay, so in the third phase of the crisis, the CEB addressed the onset of the credit crunch and the risk of deflation, so that you can see there was a threat of having a credit crunch and also the risk of deflation. Short-term interest rates already close to zero, but there is no way to reduce them more, because almost that the interest rates are almost near to the zero. So how the central bank can boost the economy by changing the interest rate, there is no way. So at that time, what the central bank can do? So here you can see some measures. So intended to influence the whole set of interest rates that are relevant for financing condition in the euro area. So what are the measures? Negative interest rate on the deposit facility, which means that for the deposits that the banks are going to keep with the central bank, there is a negative interest rate. Means that it is kind of that we know that when the banks are going to deposit with the central bank, that central bank has to pay interest. But this is the opposite of it. The when the banks need to keep deposits, means that they have to pay negative interest, that they have to pay the central bank. So it is called the, that that's how that central bank encouraged to make more liquidate the market. Targeted longer term refinancing operation designed to support bank lending to business and households. So that refinance operation, like that we that in Sri Lanka also, that we saw that central bank start to lend the banks under refinance schemes created in order to facilitate business and household affected by the health crisis during the pandemic. Like in the same way that those because of that crisis situations, this bank also have taken such measures. and asset purchase programs involving private and public sector securities to put downward pressure on the term in, structure of the interest rates. So it is the one more thing, because we know that when the central bank is changing the policy interest rates, normally we know that in the short term market rates are going to be changed, but it will take long time to change the other interest rate, especially the long-term base assets, right? So that's why that central bank, that ECB, started purchasing some asset purchase programs, APP. So that's how going to be influence on the market interest rate directly. Otherwise, that we cannot see the central banks are doing any influence. So there is no direct influence on the market rates, but through the policy rates that central banks are influencing the market rate, but it takes time, right? That that mechanism takes time. But because of that crisis situations, this is one of the additional measure taken by the Euro Central Bank to address the issues. And the other thing is the forward guidance, which means communicating how the central bank expects its policy measures to evolve in the future and what conditions would warrant a change in the policy stance. So here, which means that the central bank announced the future policies, that what are the policies the central bank is going to take. So accordingly, the people that believe, that they believe that the situation is going to be improved, accordingly that the, actually it is to build up the confidence of the people. When the confidence is there, that central bank always to need to guide the market to take their decisions with confidence. Okay, but we know that in a crisis situation, always that there is no certainty. Uncertainty is there. So in order to control that uncertainty, always that central bank has to give some forward guidance. So by giving some positive signals that it can influence the decisions of the people, they are going to think positive and their reactions are going to be again react in a good way to make the condition better. So that's what the forward guidance. Okay, so that always, we already discussed about the way people think, and that the way of people think is always matters, right? So that they take their decisions, or sometimes they are not going to take their decision because of they believe and take the conditions. So if there is a way that improve the confidence, level of confidence of the people, to create more certainty, that it will help. Okay, so these are the non-standard measures had been taken by the European Central Bank in the time of financial crisis. Okay, so then we are going to discuss about the Bank of England. So the Bank of England, you know that Bank of England, where the Bank of England is, it is in UK, which is often touted as one of the world's most effective central banks. So that's why we are discussing about that, most effective central banks. It is considered as most effective central bank. Bank of England established in 1694 as a private institution with the power to raise money for the government by issuing bonds. What was the original objective of establishing that entity? Okay, but 1844, the Bank Charter Act gave it, for the first time, monopoly on issuing banknotes in England and Wales. thus taking a major step toward being a modern central bank. So we at the time that we discussed about the evolution of central bank, we saw most of the central banks around the world, actually they were originated in the form of a private entity to facilitate government fund needs. Here that we can see that the case of Bank of England is also very similar to that, but later on that the role is changed. Role it has been changed into a modern central bank where they get the sole authority of issuing bank notes. Now the mission of the Bank of England is to maintain stability in its monetary and financial system. So in this very short sentence that you can see, it covers the same two key objectives of the Central Bank of Sri Lanka as well: stability in the monetary and the financial system. To accomplish this, the central bank has an inflation target of 2%. So it is now you can see that the Fed, they are having the target of 2%. Euro central banks, their target is below 2%. The Bank of England, they again have the inflation target of 2%. If prices surpass that level, the central bank control inflation. Okay, while a level far below 2%, while prompt the central bank to take measures to boost inflation. So, which is called the stable prices. When it is going to be go up or down, it is not good. Higher inflation or deflation, both are not good. Okay, so that's why even it is going far below 2%, that central bank has to take measures. Okay, to boost, to take it into the correct path near around 2%. Further, it has wide range of responsibilities similar to most of other central banks around the world as the government's bank, the lender of last resort, and issuing currency. So already we discussed about the role of issuing currency, but the Bank of England is also have the role, also they also plays the role of government's bank. Like the same way, the Central Bank of Sri Lanka is also having the same role. The banker to the government and also the lender of last resort. I'm not going to explain what is the lender of last resort because we have already discussed at the beginning, okay, under the role of the Central Bank of Sri Lanka. And the next thing is the Bank of England also ensures the soundness of the nation's financial institutions, which means the safe and sound banks, the security of its currency, secure cash, and its financial system is free from unnecessary risk. It's a resilient financial system, right? So these are the other responsibilities given. Okay, so in order to align with the mission of the Bank of England, that you can see now, that mission is given as to maintain stability in the monetary and financial system. So with respect to the stability in the monetary system, that we can see their role of implementing the monetary policy, right? Stability of the financial system, that we can see that safe and sound bank system, a resilient financial system, and secure cash is also again aligned with these two stability objectives as well. Okay, so that the secure cash is needed to facilitate both the objectives in broad manner, right? Okay, now we are going to discuss about the monetary policy of the Bank of England. The Bank of England set monetary policy to achieve the government's target of keeping inflation at 2%. So they use two main monetary policy tools: the interest rate that the Bank of England charge bank to borrow money from the Bank of England, which is called the bank rate. Okay, bank rate. It is also called Bank of England base rate. It influences the rate those banks charge people to borrow money or pay on their saving. You can understand it. When, what is the rate for the banks to available funds is again determine the rate for the availability of money for the general public as well, because the funds are available at a particular rate for the banks means that banks are using those funds. The cost of that fund is that interest rate. So based on that cost, that they have to decide what is the rate that they have to give to their customers. So likewise, that we can see by changing the bank rate, it can change the market interest rates as well. Okay, the next one is asset purchase or quantitative easing. So this measure is used to inject money directly into the economy. Okay, money is either physical like bank notes or digital or by corporate and government bonds. So that they are injecting money in a form of cash, or it can be also a digital money by using the government bonds. So that Bank of England can purchase government debts or the securities, okay? And also that actually it creates new money, which means that, you know, that we already discussed when the central bank also going to purchase government securities, that it is going to be record as an asset in the central bank balance sheet. Then central bank has to pay, because central bank is going to buy, so that amount of currency is going out of the central bank, so it is recorded as the liability. So by that amount, the liquidity in the market is also going to be increased. Okay, by creating this money, this new money, Bank of England aim to boost spending and investment in the economy. When there are more money in the system, right? So you know that spending is going up. We discussed that, right? And also the investment as well. So that's how that economic activity or the output can be increased. Okay, then we are going to discuss about the Monetary Policy Committee. Monetary Policy Committee is responsible on deciding what the monetary policy actions to be taken in order to meet the objectives. MPC is made up of 9 members. The governor, I mentioned the name here for your information, and 3 deputy governors are there with respect to the area of monetary policy, financial stability, and markets and banking. 3 separate areas, 3 different deputy governors are there. So they are the members of this Monetary Policy Committee. And also chief economist of the England Bank is also there. And 4 external members are also appointed directly by the Chancellor to make sure that the MPC benefits from thinking and expertise from outside of the Bank of the England. Okay, so we saw at the time that we discussed about the Monetary Board of the Central Bank of Sri Lanka also, that we saw some outside experts are there representing the Monetary Board, right? And also that we saw that Secretary to the Treasury is also there, right? It is by mandate, he's there. Work as a member of the Monetary Board, right? So that you can see the based on the composition of the committees, actually it shows us how the decisions are represent the real need of an economy, and also how far the decisions are independent and all. So that's why that always when we are discussing about a committee, who are the members is important. Okay, so that you can see And also that their term period is also important. Okay, MPC members serve fixed terms after which they may be either replaced or reappointed. So you can see that the consistency or continuity of the process has been established by giving fixed terms. Okay, a representative from Treasury also sit with the MPC as its meeting to make sure that the MPC is fully briefed on fiscal policy developments and other aspects of the government economic policies, but it is not allowed to vote. So here you can see that that's what I wanted to tell you. I already mentioned you in the Monetary Board of the Central Bank of Sri Lanka. Also, the Secretary of the Treasury is representing the Monetary Board. So at that time, we can see the same thing that they are that he's there to check whether the monetary policy decisions are aligned with the fiscal policy developments of the country or any other aspects of the economy is going to be affected or whether it is going to be promoted. Likewise, that there should be a balance in between the fiscal policies and the monetary policies. That's why that representation is really important. But here also it has said that but that member is sitting in the committee, but he is not allowed to vote. Means what? That the level of independence is there. That's what it is. The MPC sets and announce policy 8 times a year, like in the same pattern that we have. And Bank of England announces the reasons behind the monetary policy decisions in quarterly monetary policy reports. So we also have the same kind of mechanism in place to announce the policy decisions and also the reasons behind those policy decisions after Central Bank of Sri Lanka that changed the monetary policy decisions or any. Even though it is not going to be changed at 8 times, you know that regular monetary policy revising committees are there. So at that time, whatever the decision that the central bank has to announce it to the public with reasons. Afterwards, that in Central Bank of Sri Lanka, that they conduct the media conference as well. Okay, so here. Again, that we were discussing about the Bank of England. Okay, the next one is the Swiss National Bank. There are a few more banks that we have to discuss about. The Swiss National Bank is an independent bank that is responsible for the Switzerland monetary policy. In June 1907, the Swiss National Bank assumed its function as an independent central bank. So that again we can see that the national banks presume managing and executive body is the governing board. So this is the they also have a governing board. It is in particular responsible for monetary policy, asset investment strategy, and international monetary cooperation. The governing board consists of 3 members. I mentioned the members' names here for your information, and also the deputies are there. It is more main goal is to maintain the stability of prices while taking due account of economic developments. In doing so, it creates an appropriate environment for economic growth. So, same, right? Same as the other central banks' key objectives. SNB equates price stability with the rise in consumer prices less than 2% per annum. So you can now see that the target is more likely similar to the other leading central banks around the world. Deflation also reaches the objective of price stability. While ago we discussed high inflation or the deflation, both not a good factors, okay, not favorable. The medium-term inflation forecasts serve as the main indicator for monetary policy decisions. Medium-term inflation forecast. So that at the time that we discuss about the inflation targeting monetary policy, we discuss that there is a target set and also the forecast in inflation is there. So accordingly, that monetary policy measures are taken in order to meet the targets. Okay, so that if the forecast shows us that there is an inflationary pressure is there, so that policy measures to be taken to tame the inflation. Okay, so in addition to the key policy objective of price stability and the key responsibility of implementing the monetary policy, what are the other responsibilities entrusted with the Swiss National Bank? Supply and distribution of cash, ensure and facilitate the functioning of cashless payment system, somewhat different than the other key responsibilities mentioned under the other central banks, right? That they have to facilitate functioning of cashless payment system. So it is that it is more what close to the objective of other central banks in terms of developing the payment and settlement systems. Actually, in order to facilitate functioning of cashless payment systems means that that central bank needs to provide facilities for such cashless payments, which means digital transaction alls, right, by developing the payment and settlement systems. So in addition to secure the and secure the that ensure the security and the efficiency of the payment and settlement system, the development is also is a matter here, because this Swiss National Bank, they need to promote and facilitate more digital transactions. Okay, so even though in our context also that nowadays that Central Bank of Sri Lanka also promoting digital transactions and also promoting cashless society concept, but in the mandate that it has not clearly defined separately. Okay, but here we can see under the key responsibilities that we can see that it is there. And the asset management contribute to the stability of the financial system, banker to the confederation, and the statistics means that collection data and compiling data relating to the economic and financial sectors. Okay, the next one is, hold on a minute. Okay, hope that you all are with me, because no one is answering any asking anything. I'm not sure whether you can understand everything that I'm explaining, but I hope because of the background knowledge that you have, because we have already discussed several aspects of the central bank under the in the context of Central Bank of Sri Lanka. So at that time we discussed about the role and responsibilities of the central bank, especially the monetary policy of the central bank. So now today we are discussing about the monetary policy and other roles and responsibilities of the other central banks. So that we saw that sometimes we can see that different objectives are there, but almost all the objectives, key objectives are similar. And also you have to understand under the monetary policy mechanisms, what are the differences? Okay, that's what the important point here that you have to understand. Okay, so that we saw that sometimes that they can use different tools. Okay, so that under the ECB, we discussed about some new measures that they had to implement because of the under the crisis situation, and also that we saw some different measures are there, right? In addition to giving focus on the price stability objective, sometimes that some monetary authorities that they have to give more focus on the exchange rate policies. At the time that we are going to discuss about the Singapore Monetary Authority, that we can see. So likewise, that you have to understand that aspects. Okay, otherwise that you may feel very bored because that set of words that I'm reading to you, like, but can't help. The nature of the subject is like that, right? So I can't help it, because and here that we cannot go in depth of some of the aspects, because in the past papers also that we can see the level that they expect you to write the answers, so that you have to have overall idea, but in order to, you know, recognize the things that you have kind of a background information or the knowledge. That's why in the earlier lectures I try my best to discuss with you the at the time that we discuss about the monetary policy. Hope you remember that we discuss about several aspects, right? So, and also that how the central bank, you know, functions or the activities impact on the activities of the economy. So based on that understanding, I hope that you can understand the points that I have given in this lecture material. So if you cannot understand anything, no problem, that you can ask me, right? But I recommend you to read it carefully and understand the difference between, because when there is something different than the other central banks, this is the point where most probably you will be asked, okay, in the exam, but what is the difference? Why it is like that? Okay, so that's what you have to understand. Okay, so so that we are running out of the time, but I just wanted to at least finish with the Swiss National Bank, so that we discuss up to here, I think, so that so then now we are going to discuss about the monetary policy of the Swiss National Bank. They implement monetary policy by setting SNB policy rates. So time to time, you can see in the past papers also, very simple questions, but sometimes it is, you will be messed up with the name of the policy rates and all. So you better remember the name of these policy rates, so that they use the Swiss National Bank policy rate, which is called the SNB policy rates. Okay, so in doing so, it keeps to keep the short-term Swiss finance, they should be finance, I think. No, it's franc, they are a monetary unit. Swiss franc money market trades close to the SNB policy rate. The same thing. So we, you know, that we, the central bank also, we have policy rates. So the key idea of having those policy rate is to influence the short-term money market trades to keep close into that policy rates. The same story here. In order to influence monetary policy conditions, Swiss National Bank also intervenes in the foreign exchange market as necessary. So that it especially mentioned in their website also. You have to understand that aspect also. Monetary policy conditions, that in order to influence the monetary policy conditions, that central bank can intervene in the foreign exchange market as well. What it means, right? So you have to have that understanding, how it is going to be changed when the central bank is going to intervene into the foreign exchange market, how it is going to change the monetary policy aspects. Okay, that's what you have to understand. As I will tell you, as an example, let's say that we saw in the recent past there was a huge pressure on the exchange rate in Sri Lanka, which means that our currency is started to depreciate at a very substantial level. At that time, how the central bank can control it? The central bank can intervene into the foreign exchange market, but how? How? Because why the our national currency is getting deteriorated? Because there is high demand for the US dollars, but the availability of US dollars is that supply of dollars is really low level of supply. So at that time, what the central bank can do? Central bank can intervene to the foreign exchange market by selling US dollars. Okay, so by selling US dollars means what? That going to absorb some rupee currency from the market. So you can see the influence of engaging the foreign exchange market into the money supply. The local money supply is going to be decreased. Okay, so likewise that here you can see that in order to influence the monetary policy conditions, Swiss National Bank also intervenes in the foreign exchange market as necessary. Okay, so that normally that I'm not pretty sure whether we discuss about the limitations of implementing the monetary policy in a country here. In our case, that we can see when the central bank is going to control the exchange rate, there can be sometimes undue influence, that unexpected influence on the monetary policy stance. That's what you have to understand. Okay, the SNB can influence money market rates by means of its open market operation. Okay, so money market rates by means of open market operation, or adjust the interest rates on side deposits. So here the same way that the Central Bank of Sri Lanka influence the money market, even by the open market operations or by change in the policy interest rates. Okay, so then what is the Swiss National Bank policy rate? It was introduced in 2019, replacing the target range for the 3 months LIBOR rate. Okay, the they set the level of policy rate and use it, communicate it as the monetary policy decision. So they are going to change the rate and they are going to communicate. It keeps to keep the secured short-term money market rate close to this policy rate. Right, the focus is on the Swiss average rate overnight as the most representative of the short-term Swiss franc rate. So this story is very, very similar to our story, because why? At the time that we discuss about the monetary policy mechanism, that we discuss about the average weighted average overnight call money market rate, right? It is like it was our immediate operating target that we saw in the process. Okay, so the same way, by changing the Swiss National Bank rate also, that it is going to influence that Swiss average rate overnight rate, that which is the rate that bank doing their transactions on overnight basis. Okay, so it is the short term money market rate. And some unconventional measures also that we can see. When interest rates are at very low levels, that there is no way to take them down anymore, this increasingly narrows the scope for further interest rate reductions. So if a central bank want to further ease its monetary policy in such environment, it must turn to unconventional measures. This is where actually many of the central bank around the world had to follow unconventional measures, because that at the crisis that they wanted to ensure that more liquidity they are in the system, but when there is a limit now to them to take the policy interest rate लोग व्हेन दे आर गोइंग टू बी वेरी क्लोज टू द जीरो लेवल, देर इज नो वे दैट दे कैन नॉट टेक देम डाउन, राइट? सो दैट्स व्हाई दे नीड टू थिंक ऑफ सम अनकन्वेंशनल मेजर्स टू इंजेक्ट मनी टू द सिस्टम. The most important unconventional measures taken by the Swiss National Bank in recent past have been intervention in the foreign exchange market. So that's what we saw in the first here also, that's why it is mentioned here like this. At that time, what the central bank can do, that central bank, that Swiss National Bank can buy foreign currencies. Okay, so when buying foreign currencies, that they can inject the domestic currency into the market. So likewise can increase the liquidity level. But here the thing is that there is a, again, impact on the foreign exchange rate as well. The temporary setting of the minimum exchange rate against the euro and the reduction of negative interest rate on sight deposits by banks and other financial market participants and the SNB. So when central bank needs to inject more money, so that central bank has to buy currencies, okay, buy foreign currencies, more and more foreign currencies has to buy, so that we can see that always that exchange rate will go down. Okay, so that in order to inject local currency or the domestic currency, the self-holding currencies, which means that there is low supply of foreign currencies, so that the exchange, the domestic currency is going to be highly appreciated. So the exchange rate is going to, I mean, in the direct terms of in, that, there is two way that we can depict the exchange rate. I always referring to the direct quote of the exchange rate. And accordingly, that rate is exchange rate is going to be decreased. That what it is. I'm not pretty sure whether you can understand the stories behind this, all those sentences, but I just wanted to mention that there are some unconventional measures have been taken by these central banks. Because you should know about these unconventional measures, because time to time that we can see in the past papers also, they have they raise question about such measures. Okay, what is the objective of these measures like that, and which central bank introduced this measure? Seems very simple questions, but there are different central banks are there. Implemented different measures, so you better have clear understanding. The temporary setting of minimum exchange rate against the euro, and also the introduction of negative interest on sight deposit that we already discussed about the negative deposits rates, where the banks are that actually that central bank needs to discourage the banks to keep deposits with the central bank so that can ensure that more liquidity are there in the market. When there is a negative interest means that they are not going to have anything, but instead that they have to pay for the deposits that they have been keep with the central bank. Okay, so it is kind of a penalty if they are going to keep their additional excess liquidity with the central bank. So that's why they have to lend this liquidity. They have to use this liquidity for the lending purposes. Okay, so I think that time is up, so that there are how many more banks they have to, we have to talk about another three banks: Deutsche Bundesbank, Monetary Authority of Singapore, and Bank of Japan. So the time is up, so that I think better we discuss them on the next week. Thank you so much for listening. So no one raised questions today. Let me check. There is no nothing in chat box. Hope that you can understand. Actually, already the IBSL has shared materials with you, right? But those materials are the materials that I've used last time. but I have updated the materials this time. So the latest materials that I will be make available through the IBSL. So remember that you have to use the latest materials. I will check with IBSL whether they can remove them from the system and or replace with this new materials. Okay, anyhow, that you have to follow the new materials, because some especially the Fed reserves, that they have changed their official website, like, so that we have to I had to update some of the points that we discuss. Okay, thank you so much. So we are going to meet again the next week. I hope that we can finish all the topics that we have to discuss under this subject within next 3 weeks, probably. Yes, there are three. We have to discuss about the central bank independence and also the recent trends and developments. So I think that basically we have two key topics are there more. So within 3 weeks, I hope that we can finish the lessons. Okay, thank you so much, everyone.